In ancient land of perfect hitboxes and amazing boss design, welcome back. And this land is also known as Dark Souls 2. But anyway, in this video I wanna talk a little bit about DLC. For all Dark Souls game, even if technically Dark Souls 1 doesn't have DLC, or don't have DLC, actually the Artorias, Manus, Calamite and Sanctuary Guardian and entire arena and Oclane, Okile, you know, this Sanctuary Garden and everything, that is DLC area because you have to pay for it. It is free on PC, but for some platforms, on some platforms, this is like you have to pay to play this content. So yeah, with my first talk about Dark Souls 1, as I am progressing through this amazing forest, killing butterflies. Those butterflies are way better than Moonlight Butterfly. So Dark Souls 1 has 4 bosses, as I mentioned. Sanctuary Guardian, which technically after single one you can fight with 2 at once, but we're gonna be only counting the single one. So then you have Artorias, Calamite and Manus. And well, bosses are way better than in original game, that's for sure. Like, there are no... Excuse me? I was for some reason stuck there. But anyway, so bosses are very good designed, like Artorias is one of my favorite from Dark Souls 1. Manus is complete trash. I mean, he is hardest, obviously, because he has to be the hardest, but he's... If you see in my video, when I tried to beat him in NG+, many times I got raised by annoying bullshit. And he's not hard by his, like, magic attack that you can anticipate where and expect when he is about to do them. Because you actually know when he's about to do them. The only problem is it is hard to use pendants to defend yourself from his magic. But you can simply roll away and roll around. The problem is if you get hit once and you have no poise, you will take full damage from his, like, dark spells. And usually this is like one shot. If you don't have like heavy armor or something heavy armor, this is gonna be one shot. Especially in NG+. I mean, if you play in regular... if you play with Strange Bolt, Sword and Shield, you can use shield that you will get if you will rescue C from Abyss. And this shield is purposely created to help you with Calamite and Manus. Because it has very, very cool magic resistance, which again proves the dark magic does magic damage. It doesn't do dark damage at all, it just does magic damage, but you know, way better than regular soul spears and soul arrows. So yeah, that's pretty much confirmation. Unless I said something wrong. What stats of this shield has? I never really used shield in Dark Souls as soon as I noticed how broken it is. So yeah, this is pretty much my conclusion for Dark Souls 1 DLC. Artorias is the best, Manus is complete trash, Calamite is decent to fight, and Sanctuary Guardian is honestly unmemorable for me. I guess he doesn't have any bullshit attack that one-shots you immediately, like Manus combo, that even if you see he's doing this now and you wanna dodge away, you still can, because you know, his range of this juggling combo is so good. So yeah, because Sanctuary Guardian doesn't have any attack created, which will hit you no matter what. I think he's also very good design. So let's just move to Dark Souls 2, and Dark Souls 2 has the most amount of DLC from all games. But not always numbers means quality, right? And I'm pretty sure I don't remember what is order of releasing of DLC, but I think Shulva and Sunken King Crown was first. Then it was Broom Tower with Fume Knight and Seralon. And at the end, it was the Eleum Lois, Frozen Eleum Lois. And I guess the second DLC with Fume Knight and Seralon are the best. Even if there is no purpose for Smelter Demon to be there, but at least his weapon is really good. Like, his blue smelter sword is way better than fire smelter sword, so yeah. I'm glad they added him just because you can get his soul and get his amazing weapon, which is great in PvP and looks amazing in PvP. Like, it is very stylish to use this. And many people don't know the smelter demon actually does damage from magic. He doesn't do fire damage at all anymore, he does magic damage. The regular Smelter Demon does fire damage, and I don't get it why people don't understand this. Like, you think blue is only for fashion? Like, you think he is only blue because, you know, From Software had nothing to do than drew stress-skinned bosses and that's it? I mean, they doing this mostly with Dark Souls 2 and Dark Souls 1. And sometimes even in Dark Souls 3, but overall, no. Smelter Demon is probably only one who, besides different, like, reskinned model, also does something different. Because he has different attack animation, attack animation and moveset is the same, but his delay is totally different than original Smelter Demon. Like, he can delay his attack even up to 5 seconds, I think. So he's very hard to predict, way harder than original Smelter Demon, which always swings with the same speed. So yeah. And there is also additional thing where Blue Smelter Demon, if he's buffing himself, he also does little bit AoE attack. And Smelter Demon, regular Smelter Fire Demon, doesn't do that, so there goes this. And I guess Fume Knight is the best boss in this game, because it's actually one of the couple bosses which also has, just like Smelter Demon and Velstrad, second phase, except his second phase is way more, how to call it, advanced. Better designed, you know, he has way more attacks and he is like totally different in second phase. It's not just like with how dare you heal. It's not like with Smelter Demon or Velstrad at all, where he only has different, where he only has buff on weapon. No, he has totally new attack. He has like projectile, which are not really projectile, it's just fireballs flying when he does AoE. And yeah, he has like totally different moveset, and that's very, very cool. And this is why I like Fume Knight the most, even if he's one of the hardest boss to fight. I don't think I ever beat him on NG+7. Because he does so much damage to you and taking so little damage. I think the best score that I had on him was NG+4. I think this is like my record. On NG+5 I couldn't even beat him, so I just gave up and I didn't try it further on. So yeah. That's basically confirmation how hard it is. And there is also the thing with, if you beat Seralon without taking damage, he will do different animation. He will basically do seppuku. Which I long time call it, long time I was calling this animation the Harakiri thing. But Harakiri actually does Ishin in Sekiro. Seralon doesn't do Harakiri at all. But yeah, the Broom Tower and everything, that is my favorite DLC. And about last DLC for Dark Souls 3, the Leo voice, I don't really know what to talk about because they reskinned bosses and they created one of the worst boss in the Soul history. I'm not saying it is like the better version of Bed of Chaos, because Bed of Chaos is the worst from the worst, but Lut and Zeylen are maybe they are not gonna be that bad, if not the fact this is like DLC that you have to pay to play. So you have to pay to play, reskinned boss fight. They clearly was like running out of ideas what they can put into DLC, so they pretty much just took last boss which they created, or almost last boss, depend. And yeah, I don't even understand why they call the inscription of soul of Ava. You can read King has 7 pets, and if we can't loot and Zeylen and Ava, that's just 3. So where the hell are other 4, I wonder? I guess reskinned more bosses and put more tiger into the game would be just silly, so they could just say King has 3 pets instead 7. And well, I should say something about Sanctum City and Alana, but I don't know what. The idea for Alana summoning Vesrat is also pretty shitty and only one what makes fight difficult. The fight by itself, if Alana could only summon skeletons or pig, would be actually acceptable because you can one-shot them. But if Alana will decide to summon Velstrat, and I remind you, this boss can summon multiple Velstrat, not at once, but if you kill Velstrat, she can summon immediately another one. So there is pretty much no point to killing her Velstrat if she summoned him, because other gonna be summoned eventually. So yeah, you have to then fight with Alana and Velstrat in the same time, and there is completely no point for this. You might just homeward bone and leave, and just try again counting Alana will not summon Velstrat. And yeah, that's why I don't like this fight too much. He would be like this boss who would be better version of Nashandra if not this fucking Velstrat mechanic. And I don't care about lore. Like, fuck the lore, seriously. Lore can defend game design, in my opinion. Regardless how good lore is, it won't defend shitty boss design. Or maybe it was only again good idea of One second, I'm trying to focus because I have no poise to this boss fight. But yeah, I disliking Alana because of this. Like, I already said that if skeletons and pigs would be only one what can be summoned by her, it would be fine. But with Velstrat, it's not fine. It's seriously random fest. And I seriously, every time when I'm getting Velstrat, I'm just leaving and trying again. Because you have in Dark Souls 2 introduced an item that works like infinite version of Homeward Bone. So seriously, you might just use this item when you see Velstrat is being summoned and you have enough time to use this. So yeah, that's pretty much my thought about Alana. Sin is kinda like better version of Ancient Dragon, because Ancient Dragon is just boring and annoying, and Sin is slightly better. And among Gang Squad, which is like Havel, Ava, and Lucatil, I don't wanna even talk really, because this boss is just silly and there is not even really reward for doing this. I mean, you get like Twinkling Night Knight and Slabs, but in Dark Souls 2 there are bonfire aesthetics, so you can get those way easier without playing shitty bosses such as those. So, yeah, this is my thought about this DLC, and the idea in Eleum Lois of collecting knights to, you know, you collecting knights and they're gonna help you later in boss fight. This idea was really cool, and Old Iron King is also a very cool boss fight, but I don't understand the whole outskirts and Lutenzalen thing. If you seriously had no idea from software for boss fight, you might just leave Ava and King only. Because, you know, tell me someone has actually joy playing outskirts and fighting with reindeers, because I don't think there is a single person, even in From Software Company, who actually enjoyed this design. And with that we can go to Dark Souls 3 DLC, and Dark Souls 3 had long time only one DLC, Ariandel with Freya, but eventually they added the Ringed City DLC, and totally useless, by the way, patch which allows you to play with players with level 351 and higher easier. And my idea is, what dumbass thought it is good idea to create patch for, again, something what doesn't exist? Everyone know to stay on level 120 because this is the meta for PvP. So I don't understand patch for something what doesn't exist completely. And if you've really having fun being like overleveled garbage in Dark Souls 3 and you think this is good PvP where you are level 802, because I think this is max level, where you have like every item upgraded, every spell, every miracle and everything just the best as possible, then just you have no skill really in game, in my opinion. Dark Souls 2 is created about build, and if you are max level, build doesn't matter because you can use everything pretty much, so yeah. This is like not fun at all, and I don't understand people who's having fun. But let's just go to DLC. So first DLC has Grave Tender, his wolf, and Frida boss fight, and it's only two, but actually Frida has like three phases. It was, I think, first boss which has three phases to fight, and it is one of the hardest bosses to fight. Again, it's gang, it's like reincarnation of Orsin and Smoke, where, you know, Freya gonna be trying to hit you from far, and you have to focus on bigger enemy in fight, which is the father of Ariandel. But the real trick was where you actually noticed even getting slap after killing second phase, it's not over and it is just the beginning. So yeah, Freda is very good boss fight and very hard to fight, especially on SL1. This is like kind of those bosses which makes you to not play SL1 anymore. And Grave Tender is honestly just garbage, and I'm glad you don't have to fight with him to get arena. You can just get the bombs to unlock arena in other DLC in better way, because this is just basically kind of like ripoff from Gang Squad in Dark Souls 2. You know, they just took one NPC that is little bit stronger, they give him health bar, title, like boss name, and bam, here's your boss fight. It's seriously what it is. This is what this is. In Dark Souls 2, you're fighting with Havel, Ava, and the last guy, Lucatil. Or maybe it is brother of Lucatil, I don't know. But anyway, you're fighting with Varg and company, and his company. But in Dark Souls 3, this is pretty much what this reminding me, what you do in this boss fight. The difference is, you have giant wolf eventually after you kill this boss. So yeah, That's why I don't like fighting with Grave Tender. And yeah. That's why I don't like him at all, and I always get in arena by playing the other DLC, the one with Midir and Gale. So let's just move to other DLC, which is gonna be basically last thing. And well, Gale is definitely last boss, like the last boss, if you know what I mean, because he will give you item if you beat him. He will give you item which is called Dark Soul, I believe it was this item. Yeah, and all what this item do is all what this item does is just grants extra 2 lines of dialogue from Geer who drawing painting in previous DLC. So that's hellas of reward for, you know, beating the hardest boss in game. Yeah, like 2 extra dialogue are very, very satisfying for beating hardest boss. Plus, of course, you can create his sword, which is the best weapon. Maybe not the best weapon, but the most stylish weapon in game. So yeah, that's what I think about this. And yeah, I need crossbow here. I hope this is enough arrows to make this count. So yeah. I might just say something about Spirit of the Church, because that was like something what was completely ripoff of Old Monk from Demon Souls, you know, where you are summoned as player to boss fight, but in Dark Souls 2 barely it happens, but you can be summoned as Looking Glass Knight Square to help him in fight, and even if you have no reward for that, it was way more fun, because, you know, Looking Glass Knight moving kinda slow and you can still win with Host. Not with Host, you can still win when you have player in your world and boss. Unless this, like, summon has, like, sorcerer or cleric build, so he can just snipe you from far. But if summoned player has like meal build, like I'm having right now, you still have decent chance to beat boss. But with Spear of the Church, there is no really like any chance to beat boss if boss has Painted Guardian, and you know, boss has like, this is basically how this gonna be working. Like when you enter boss fight, you do not. Many people does that, but I highly do not recommend to even try to fight with Judicator there, because you can't see his attacking because he's so big, like every giant in Souls history, so you will most likely get fucked by him. So stay away from him and wait until he will summon Fierce Guardian. Now, since this has happened, there are 2 scenarios what can happen next. One is you're gonna kill Guardian and then you're gonna be having clear fight with player that's being summoned. Or you will not kill Guardian in time because, you know, some random shit will happen. And basically this is GG. And I can't kill even single one with this spear. Can't kill single lizard with this spear, so we're gonna try to use this. So yeah, that's why I think the whole idea is dumb. The whole idea is dumb, and as Spear of the Church, you're most likely gonna be fighting with gangs. Because people summoning others there to, you know, to have fun, to giggle, by ruining PvP. So yeah. This is what I think about Spirit of the Church. It's garbage design that is just completely ripoff of Old Monk. Old Monk in Demon's Souls does exactly the same thing. Except in Demon Souls it was even more trash, because then you have to, just like in Dark Souls 1, you could use the grass or whatever the item was, you know, the one that gives you full heal, basically you can use that and you had like full health again, and you could just spam this over and over. So again, taking away ability so Spear of the Church can heal is also total bitch and total dick move, especially because phantoms and hosts still can heal and don't tell me, oh, but Fated Guardian can cast the sunlight thing that heals you. Yeah, but if Host has like three phantoms with him, there's not gonna be any Fated Guardian for you, because, you know, two Host and his phantom will try to kill you, and the other two phantoms gonna kill Fated Guardian in moment when he's gonna be spawned. So yeah, this is most likely how this boss fight looks and why it's completely dumb. And I guess I supposed to also say something about Midir design. Well, I like Midir. He is full dragon. He is actually blind, like not many people know. But Midir is actually blind. Like he either has no eyes or he has like small eyes. Kind of. Moles also having small eyes such as those. Such as him, I mean. Like he really. I don't know why I said that, but. Yeah. Midir basically for me has no eyes, but don't worry, he don't need eyes to see you because his hitbox is so fucked up. Like look at his fire, like the way how his fire just spread on ground, that's kinda insane. I don't remember Calamite had like range so fucked up. Seriously, they seriously overdid it with Midir fire breath, I'm sorry. Like, the fact he can use laser during his fire breath is one, and it's kinda okay. But if you're standing below Midir and he will decide to use fire breath, you will most likely will not escape, because this fire breath has so much range and does so much damage. But overall, it is very good. Dragon fight, like one of the best dragon fight in Souls history, in my opinion, and I like it. Like, if not the Spirit of the Church, and the, by the way, about Demon Prince and Demon from Below and Demon in Pain, I'm not gonna be even talking about, because it is another gang fight. Like, putting only Demon Prince would be totally fine. Or just one demon, like Demon from Below, and when you kill him, you're fighting with Demon Prince. Putting two demons that are completely the same, and by the way, I'm dead. Even if I quit, I'm gonna be taken down by Fireball. No, I'm still alive, surprising. But putting two demons into a room where you have to fight first with them, like be ganked, and then fight with Demon Prince, was completely dumb in my opinion. It is not difficult and it is not fun at all. The better idea would be to either completely remove Demon in Pain and Demon from Below, or just leave one demon, and when you kill that demon, you're fighting with Demon Prince. You know? That would be way better. So yeah, that's why I don't like this fight, and that's why I don't like Spear of the Church, because this is just, I not say it is better version of Old Monk from Demon's Souls, it's just as trash as Old Monk was. But yeah, it is what it is, not everything has to be perfect. But I guess from all DLC that are, I guess this time Dark Souls 1 wins. Because there is many bosses, I guess if Manus decide to not do his 5-hit combo that hits you no matter what, or if you have like actually decent weapon, or you have build that allow you to run away, no, that's not possible, but if you have build with shield that allows you to block all of his hits, he is actually good boss design. It's just when you have no shield and you have to dodge this fucking broken bullshit, this is where frustration comes to play. So yeah, this is my thought about what DLC is the best. I will say Dark Souls 1, and what the best boss is for me is Artorias, and I bet many people will agree, because Artorias has, I said this is not about lore, but Artorias also had like great lore, and there is also extra respect for him because he has broken arm. Like, probably not many people notice first time, but Artorias actually fighting with you with broken arm. So yeah, that's what I think about DLC, and yeah, Dark Souls, if I could have do ranking, I would say Dark Souls 1 has first place, then on second place is Broom Tower with Film Knight, on third place is the Ringed, no, not the Ringed City, there is Ariandel, then there is the Sanctum City with Elana and everything, and then there is Ringed City, and at the end there is, you know, the one that left with Eumlois, yeah, this one. So this is my ranking. As always, if you don't like this ranking and you don't like me and everything, just leave dislike and prove my point about you are pathetic and you have no respect for anything and anyone on world. And I'm gonna be very glad if you did it, because it's only proving my point. And actually, yeah, I know this. I was gonna say, actually, if I'm gonna try to fight with this guy, this sorcerer will hit me, because, yeah, I don't even have this spell in my inventory. Like, that's kinda not fair. Oh well, I guess that's all what I wanna say. I just wanted to make short video with another opinion for you. So yeah, why not just make opinion about DLC? It's really decent subject, and overall all DLC are great. Like, are there all DLC having some flaws and some good bosses? Like, there is no really DLC where every boss is perfect in any game. There is always something wrong, and there is always something good and very good. So yeah, this is what I wanna say. And as last thing, I guess we might just kill Jabba Hutt here. So yeah, Convestus Demon. This is gonna be my outro. I honestly, I know you can cut off tail of this chubby little demon, but yeah, it's gonna, the hitbox of this demon is kinda weird. I wish there exists mod that actually, like, changing color in moments where, that showing you exactly what body part of boss has hitbox, because it would be great for this boss fight. But anyway, that was it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed, and if so, well, check others. And as I said, if no, then just leave dislike. And I'm not gonna be sad at all, I'm gonna be happy because you proved my point. So, thank you, have a nice day, and goodbye.